Welcome to Space News from the Electric Universe, brought to you by the Thunderbolts Project at thunderbolts.info. In early September of 2017, dramatic weather and seismic events reminded human beings around the world of the awesome power of nature. On September 7th, an 8.1 earthquake struck off of the Pacific coast, the largest quake in Mexico in a century. Just one day previous, Hurricane Irma, a tremendously powerful storm that originated near the Cape Verde Islands, reached its peak intensity with winds of 185 miles per hour. The hurricanes Katia and Jose followed on Irma's heels. And less than 2 weeks after the Mexico quake, a second tremor, this one 7.1 magnitude, struck the region. Only 2 days after the second Mexico quake, additional significant earthquakes occurred at the Pacific island of Vanuatu and just off the northeast coast of Japan, respectively. Are such clusters of natural disasters on our planet merely a coincidence? The key to answering the question is an understanding of the dynamic electromagnetic relationship between the Earth and the Sun. Increasingly mainstream scientific research has shown a dramatic connection, completely unexpected in standard reasoning, between intense solar activity and atmospheric and weather events on Earth. For instance, in 2014, we reported on a scientific study which showed intense and sustained increased lightning on Earth following solar storms. Is it then a coincidence that in early September, the Sun erupted with its largest solar flare in 12 years? For the past several years, Thunderbolt's colleague Ben Davidson, the founder of Suspicious Observers, has produced voluminous research on space weather and its link to numerous geophysical phenomena. More recently, Ben and scientific colleagues have worked to develop models of disaster prediction. And in 2015, Ben and co-authors Kongpop Uyen and Christopher Holloman co-authored a peer-reviewed scientific paper on the connection between solar activity and very large earthquakes. In the first of this two-part presentation, Ben begins discussing the evolution of his own investigation and the growing body of evidence of the sun's effect on climate, weather, and earthquakes.
It was really quite the start to September, a bit of a bittersweet one, which is not something we're not used to when it comes to forecasting natural disasters, when every time you have a success, it is also a somber reality of what has just happened. Back in 2011, 2012, 2013, and 2014, a number of patterns between solar and other cosmic phenomena and earthly phenomena, both meteorological and seismic, began to come together in a way that was not just obvious to a few people, but obvious to tens of thousands of people who happened to be watching someone who got lucky enough to pick three interesting things they wanted to show every day, and that is what the sun was doing, what the earth, what the earthquakes were doing, and what the weather was doing. And sort of by accident, all of these patterns started to just show up. In 2015, a few papers were published, and we are doing continued research still, but we are finding that things are moving along and progressing in the understanding of how the sun is, for lack of a better phrase, electromagnetically forcing short-term weather events and seismic activity in a number of different ways. It's progressing so fast that really the only way we can think of to share and get this out there for people to understand and improve is just to continue reporting on this stuff every day and letting people know what the patterns are that we think they see and that we think that we have seen as well. Back in 2015, we were able to really bring this to the forefront because after the sun had been relatively quiet for quite a long time, and it was, say, somewhat lackluster start to the tropical season, we had really an incredible uptick in solar activity in the span of just about a week. It caused level four, which is the second highest you can have, level four out of five geomagnetic storms. They actually shut down the airspace over New Zealand at that time. And for only the second time in recorded meteorological history, six tropical cyclones spun in the Pacific. Really just, to the world, it was a great coincidence, but when it continued happening, you know, throughout the rest of the year into September, and then again in November, and then in January as well, we began to look back in time and say, hey, this actually holds true. And it's not just that the sun is having really grand activity, it's that there is a change in the solar activity. And so during solar maximum, which happens every 11 years or so, the sun is producing a lot of sunspots and a lot of solar flares. And if you are in the middle of that, maybe a drastic run of solar flares is normal for that month or that year in time. But when you look back to these periods where you have, you know, these unexpected upticks in solar activity, or you are in a period where you expect to have high activity and you have low activity for a while, and then it picks back up. It's that sort of ramping back up of that distribution of energy, not only from the solar flare X-ray emission throughout the solar system, but from those, you know, charged particle plasma cloud shock waves that I mentioned earlier that travel throughout the solar system that are powerful enough to create those incredible displays, take out satellites, affect telecommunications, internet, things like that. And so you have to really look at an energetic change that is taking place throughout the solar system. And that is precisely what we had happen again just at the beginning of September. It actually began in the middle of August when, after literally weeks, I would say maybe months, without too much going on in terms of sunspot production, and definitely not much going on in terms of the solar flares and the big blasts that go throughout the solar system, we had a flurry of sunspots being produced, and the solar flares began to come back in the middle of August, right around that period. It was not long after that that Harvey sort of formed and took that run at Houston. And then we had a little break in solar activity, and then we had a little break in the tropical systems. But then, just as fast as the break came, we had another sunspot that was born out of nowhere. And it was born on the sun, on the Earth-facing disk, while a very large and mature sunspot sat very calmly and quietly and silently in the northern hemisphere. This thing was born on the south, and it turned into a monster very, very quickly, fired a number of solar flares, including the 14th largest officially that has ever been seen. And this was one of the largest upticks that I have ever reported, to be sure. And the last time we had a solar flare this large was 12 years ago. We had another level 4 geomagnetic storm event. These things are quite rare, to be honest. And wouldn't you know it, on the heels of that, we have 3 systems spinning in the Atlantic. Now, I know that that's not comparable to the 6 systems we had in the Pacific, but you have to realize how small the Atlantic is by comparison, and that you cannot have 6 systems lined up at tropical cyclone strength in the Atlantic Ocean at one time. And so here we see something interesting. The sunspots really getting produced back in the middle of August. When they started flaring, those sunspots disappeared out of view the day that Hurricane Harvey shot north, and the solar flare-making sunspot that was on the southern hemisphere during this triple hurricane setup that we had in the Atlantic Basin just at the start of September, when it disappeared out of view, Hurricane Irma ran north that day at Florida. Now, we got very, very lucky, because it appears that about 24 hours later, as the sunspot was out of view, it released a solar flare that was so powerful, we were actually able to detect it from Earth, even though the sunspot was not visible. It had turned over to the backside, the far side half of the sun, where, you know, Earth can't see from our perspective. And as far as I know, this is the first time, actually, that one of the shockwave clouds blasted out by a solar flare on the far side of the sun has hit Earth. Wasn't much, terrible, because, as I said, the sunspot blasted it out on the far side. But the shockwave was so broad that it had effects basically all throughout the solar system.
In the following episode, we will discuss in greater detail how and why it may be possible to predict earthquakes, particularly the largest quakes, major storms, and other dramatic environmental effects based on a new understanding of the Sun-Earth electromagnetic connection.
For continuous updates on space news from the electric universe, stay tuned to thunderbolts.info.